James B. Madonna, and the Reverend Dr. William J. Eisenman.
Okay, we are here.
Wherever here is.
Wherever here is. Yes. Naturally, we're here because you hear us.
Somewhere else. We're here because we ain't somewhere else. You know, you can't occupy two spaces at the same time.
No, we're not. Is it omnipresence?
No, we're not omnipresent. We're down here with Optimum.
Optimum Online.
Cable.
Okay. Last week I forgot to do the formalities at the beginning because it was like a storm blowing through. We were hitting so many subjects left, and you know, it was like nonstop, furious, fast and furious show. Welcome everyone to Uncensored Hard Hitting Truth. I am your host, James P. Madonna of Megalife 21, the hardest hitting internet talk radio station on the planet, and we're coming to you from the Newsletter Censored Research Center in Northeastern New Jersey. And it happens to be the almost the middle of August 2015. Almost.
Moving too fast, but it's the 8th.
Well, they say once August rolls around, the summer
is winding down
quickly. Any day now we will see Halloween items in the retail stores. Yes, sir. Any day now.
What if they'll have Trump masks this year?
I predict that Donald Trump wigs and Donald Trump masks.
Oh, definitely the wig.
Will be the biggest, hottest selling craze in Halloweeny history.
Ah.
And I think that, you know, like in the was it the 18th century when they wore those powdery wigs, you know, the politicians wore those white powdery wigs. Mm-hmm. I think that the Republicans should wear Trump wigs to replace the white powdery wigs to identify themselves. But I don't think Trump is going over too well in popularity with the Republican Party, since he cannot promise that he won't run as an independent if he doesn't get the nomination, and that he got a lot of booze. But anyway, let me just get it over with here.
Actually, he didn't get booze on that. He was applauded on that when he raised his hand.
Well, he said he cannot pledge.
Right. But why would they ask somebody to do that in the first place? Only to beat Hillary Clinton.
Well, it's obvious that Donald Trump was targeted during that debate because he's not part of the clique, the Republican Party clique. He's not a career politician. He's a businessman, and they went right for his jugular vein, and the conservative blonde Megyn Kelly wasted no time throwing those personal questions about him being a misogynist or a woman
hater.
Yeah,
well, now he's in trouble because today, I don't know if it was on Twitter or wherever, but he said something about blood. Megyn Kelly had blood coming from wherever. Which they are saying is a dig at her being on the rag.
You know what?
Having her period.
Megyn Kelly, Elizabeth Hasselbeck, no matter how you shake it, the blonde bombshells and the brunettes that are part of the conservative coven of witches of Fox News, I don't have no reason to defend them or respect them whatsoever. I know what they were doing, collectively attacking and targeting Donald Trump. The only reason why I watched the insane asylum debate is because Donald Trump was there. I find him to be very entertaining and refreshingly outspoken, which is which you can't really say that about Republicans. They were lying through their teeth.
They all have to toe the line.
They did nobody. I noticed no one during that debate discussed the plight of the poor and the middle class. It was all about repeal Obamacare. Repeal Obamacare, spend on the military, we've got to boost that military, cut taxes, of course, for the rich, immigrate, illegal immigrants, anti-immigration, the border, keep the brown people out. It was the same crap, trickle down, that whole shit about the creating jobs, and Democrats are the job killers, and Republicans are the job creators, and we have to cut taxes in order to make it happen, which is the big fantasy lie about trickle-down Reaganomics. It's the same crap, but the plight of the poor and the middle class was not mentioned.
Because they're not beholden to the middle class and the poor.
But doesn't you
play? They are beholden to corporations and the rich.
Right. Therefore,
so,
I should not
why
be.
Would you expect
I
that?
Should not be surprised or shocked.
Exactly.
Now, Marco Rubio.
Oh boy.
What is this deal about him making it sound like he grew up poor?
Paycheck to paycheck.
Paycheck to paycheck, yeah. and we. So how the hell did he become a conservative? Unless he sold out.
Unless he sold himself, you know.
I think he's a Latin Uncle Tom. I think he sold out to the fat cats. He might have very well came from a poor family, but I think he sold his people out like some pro-capitalist Miami Cubans. He sold out to the fat cats, like neurosurgeon Mr.
Ben Carson.
He's an Uncle Tom.
An Uncle Tom doesn't know anything about the Constitution.
Apparently not.
Okay.
But anyway, I forgot to introduce you.
Oh, wow.
That disembodied, mysterious voice coming Ooh. From the astral world just happens to be my illustrious co-host and partner. A mentor and the very founder of Newsletter Censored in 1977, the one and only, the Reverend Dr. William J. Eisenman. How are you feeling this week, sir?
Oh, I'm fine.
The post,
I'm really
post
fine.
Republican clown bus insane asylum
debate.
And like I said, it was torture. It was torture. Every minute of it, every minute was torture, except listening to Donald Trump. And who are those, gee, what a stupid name for an arena, the Quicken Loans Arena in Cleveland,
well,
Ohio.
They own it.
It almost sounds like the Quaker Oats Arena. You know?
What do we have over here in New Jersey? We have that, what's that one now? It's got a name on it too, from one of the
They keep on
companies.
Changing the names.
Well, because the corporations are putting their name on this stuff nowadays.
Well, you got in Los Angeles, you got the Staples Arena, because I guess the Staples office supply chain owns that now.
Yeah.
I forgot what they call the one over here. But anyway, the clown bus were, those idiots in the arena cheering for everything the Republicans were saying, all that bullshit. There can't be that many rich people in America to fill that arena. So there's a good chance that arena was filled up with middle class and poor, stupid, brain cell deficient, asshole teabaggers.
You would figure that it would be Democrats and independents and poor and middle class in Cleveland.
Cheering on people that don't give a shit about them.
Correct.
Never have and never will.
Correct.
Oh, from what I understand, what state was he in? I heard Bernie Sanders had a 20,000 people turnout. They had to move to a bigger venue recently.
I don't know where he is.
He's in...
It wasn't New Hampshire, was it?
No.
Iowa?
It'll hit me later, I hope, but it seems like the turnout's getting larger and larger for Bernie.
Well, of course, because he's the only one talking about the important stuff.
It's like, you know, he started off with moving to a bigger venue in red states and had a 10 to 13,000 plus turnout. Now he's got 20,000 turnout, and I mean, it's like they showed a Bernie Sanders map of people that really dig this guy, and there's only like a few states that were red. The rest were all blue. The rest of the United States were blue. Now, what is this horse shit coming from the Huffington Post about Bernie Sanders is he's light years behind Hillary Clinton as far as minority approval.
That would be
ridiculous. They had Bernie at 3% and Hillary at almost all of them. I mean, Hillary, the corporatist. I mean, Bernie Sanders, his plans would obviously help minorities and the poor a lot more than Hillary. Unless Hillary's got some friends over there at
depending on what poll you're talking about or whatever, they're probably just talking about the Democratic Party itself. And if you'll notice, Carly Farina and etc., when the Republicans discuss the Democratic Party, they always say Democrat. They don't say Democratic. It's the Democratic Party, not the Democrat. You know why they do that? Because they try to make it like an elitist party. You know? Democrat? Well, aristocrat?
Aristocrat? I have a question for you, Dr. Bill. Did you notice during the debate that that the Republicans collectively were very antsy about getting the troops on the ground in the Middle East to fight ISIS and Iran, and because they were, you know, supposedly want to annihilate Israel and all that stuff, but there was no mention of our so-called allies joining us to fight ISIS, you know, and it was all like the U.S. has got to do something about it and get over there and. You know, where Bernie Sanders says, hey, what about our NATO allies? What about the Saudi Arabia, the very wealthy Saudi Arabia, who has a huge military
The spender on military in the world.
Yeah, well, collectively, the supposed allies of the United States should be there fighting ISIS.
Well, it's not allies. It's their problem.
It's their problem, too.
It's in their backyard.
Because the terrorists...
It's not ours.
Because the radical terrorists also go to European countries to do...
Yeah, but they're over there. There's 30,000 ISIS whatevers. It's over there. It ain't over here. And if one or two goes to Europe, or they get a lone wolf in Europe or America, so what? Yeah. It's their problem.
Right. And of course they're 100% pro-Israel. They don't feel sorry for the poor Palestinians. You know, everything was expected, but why should the United States always foot the bill?
That's why.
Internationally, with every every international crisis.
It makes money for the private contract. War is a racket. War is business.
So what they really mean, but they will never say it in public, is that they're making money off the war.
Off the dead soldiers.
Off the dead poor and middle class children's blood.
That's correct.
Right. Not the rich kids don't get sent over there.
No. And if they do, they get shot like Tillman. by their own people.
Friendly fire?
Friendly fire.
That's funny, friendly. It's like the Clear Skies Amendment. Friendly fire. Hi.
Hi, friends.
Hi, neighbor.
Pop, 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 pop.
I want to be your neighbor. Hold on for a second. Bang, 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 bang. You know, it's like...
Jesus
friendly
Christ.
Fire.
Come on.
But anyway, oh, Tillman had a silver spoon in his mouth?
Tillman was an NFL star.
Then he
chose
money.
To go into the Army.
He chose to go...
He was killed by his own people.
He chose to go, let me guess, because...
We don't know why to this day.
He believed all the flag-waving teabagger horseshit that our security and our freedom are being threatened and we gotta go get them dar Arab Muslims or whatever. We gotta go over there.
Radical Islam.
He believed the G.W. Bush bullshit.
Yeah.
And he enlisted like many other fools, many other idiotic teabaggers believe and suck it up. The lies and I don't know.
That's all a waste. Yeah. That's all it is.
And of course one of the queen, probably the queen of conservatives on Fox News, Ann Coulter, the Gorgon, the Medusa, Ann Coulter, made a recent statement accusing all Latinos as being rapist criminals. You know. She was
going to rape your daughters.
Generalizing.
Okay.
You know. But before we... I got to mention the man who really gets under my skin. I don't know why, but he does. People like Rick Santorum and Mike Huckabee. In this case, it's Mike Huckabee. Making that bullshit statement about scientific evidence... that a fertilized egg is a human baby is totally preposterous. And they're so concerned about protecting the unborn. But if you're born and you're not rich, and which means you need help, they don't care about you at all. Hungry children don't matter to them.
There was a video up there, or a post up on Facebook the other day of an embryo.
Yeah.
And the talk of the post and etc. was that
you're pro-life.
You want to protect that. And
they show it.
And at the end, it was an elephant embryo.
And there's
it was not human.
And there's another banner on our Facebook group. Yes, it's called Uncensored Hard Hitting Truth. Join it. There is another banner of an embryo, a human embryo, or any embryo, on the left saying, if you're pro-life, you want to protect this. And then on the right, there's a photo of a starving child dressed in rags.
That's it.
And you don't care about that.
You're part of the problem.
You're not pro-life, and you're part of the problem.
Yeah.
You're not pro-life.
Yeah.
So it's Hippocratic. I mean, it's totally
hypocritical,
and they throw all these distractions at you through the corporate whore media about gay marriage and this, that, and the other thing to distract you. Before it was Caitlyn Jenner, every day. Now it's something else. So, you know, they distract you from
the big picture.
From you seeing what these conservatives are really doing behind the scenes.
Mm-hmm.
And what they're doing behind the scenes is evil, and it is with the intention of controlling your lives, enslaving you, the common folk, the mainstream masses.
Mm-hmm.
And moving forward with the corporate oligarch.
Like corporate agenda.
Like Bernie Sanders says. I'm glad he comes out and says it. The oligarch. Corporate oligarch. Oligarchy. Yeah. That's what it is.
These supporters of the conservatives and Republicans have to start learning the truth. There must be some way to knock it into their noggin. Because, just saying it is not doing the job.
I know people personally that haven't gotten it yet.
Exactly. We made that discovery some time ago when certain people have been receiving the newsletter for 30 some years or whatever, from 1977, 87, 97, 2000, 40, almost 40 years. And they're still conservative and Republican.
I wonder if they read the newsletter.
That comes to mind sometimes,
they
doesn't
might,
it?
They might take it just to be polite and pacify you and not read it.
Remember, I mentioned the other day that some Republican told me that he is going to stop receiving the newsletter if I don't say some nice things about Republicans.
That's what I have to say to you.
Well, I told him, I said, look, just do this. Read the God Project, right. Check out the scriptures, with that the four myths that I did the last issue, mm-hmm. and then check it with the Republicans on what they say and what they do and etc.
Mm-hmm.
And then you'll know what the problems are.
Right.
Don't listen to me, but don't come here with this crap just because you don't say some nice things about Republicans. We're not going to read the newsletter anymore. This is stupid.
What nice thing could you possibly say about a
That's
Republican?
Then the question I asked
Unless
was,
you're rich.
Name one good thing that the Republicans have ever
right.
done for you or the middle class and the poor. Name one.
If years have gone by, I still can't think of one.
I used to say name three, but, you know,
no.
giving them a chance. But now, name one. That's all I'm asking. Ever
well,
since Dwight D. Eisenhower, I mean, the interstate highway system, that's about it.
Right.
But that's going back to Republicans when they weren't so, teabaggy-ish.
Yeah, Dwight D. Eisenhower was like more of a moderate.
Moderate, yes.
Republican.
And when moderate was respected in the party, today it is not respected.
Yeah, Teddy Roosevelt.
You either told a lie.
Teddy Roosevelt was a moderate.
He would not be accepted in today's Republican Party.
No, he won't be far enough to the right.
That's correct.
Teddy Roosevelt or Dwight D. Eisenhower.
That is correct.
Because Dwight D. Eisenhower kept the original high tax rate on the rich.
That is correct.
He didn't cut it down.
Because they understood. That our tax. Why do you think these Republicans keep coming up with they want to get rid of the IRS?
Oh yeah, that's a
okay.
consumption taxes. Yeah,
there you go.
They want a consumption tax.
Now, who does the consumption tax hit the most?
The consumer.
Exactly.
And who is the true consumer? The little schmuck. The
little
guy.
Schmucky. He buys more refrigerators than the rich.
In general, yeah.
So he pays more tax.
So therefore, they will be assured of not paying their taxes or fair share of taxes, and the rich would also be assured of never having an IRS that will audit them, because they want to do away with the IRS.
Yes, because they hate the fact that the income tax, did you hear that? Income tax is on income. Okay.
Yeah, well, they also,
the more money you make, the more taxes you pay.
It's the most fair tax system of all.
They don't like that.
It's the most fair tax system of all. Now they, and don't forget, Eisenhower's tax rate on the rich was there before Eisenhower, and it was
it was
much higher than even Bill Clinton's tax rate on the rich.
Well, of course it was. Bill Clinton was only 39.6.
And he's a Democrat.
Jeez.
You know, and
because today you can't raise the tax rate. You can't do it.
They've
demonized it.
Well, they don't. They want to shrink. I think they want to shrink government down to next to nothing, except for the military, because they want absolutely no regulations and no watchdogs keeping an eye on them. They want to be able to do any damn thing they want. Whether it be lie and cheat and steal and screw the consumer, whether it be screwing the employee,
pollute our food,
take away
arsenic into the air,
take away labor laws, take away benefits,
the EPA,
pay employees next to nothing, bring back child labor. They want to turn back the clock to the Industrial Revolution,
when the corporations were in power.
J.P. Morgan and Rockefeller.
Yes.
Pre-union, yes. Pre-union days. They want to. They're miserable, wicked, selfish, evil, greedy scumbags. Is basically
capitalism.
What they are. It's capitalism. The devil's economics.
Yeah.
And speaking of. Everything we talk about concerning politics and conservatives versus progressives is all part of our series, Capitalism in a Conch Shell. There's the conch. Feel that.
Wait a minute. The conch ain't in there anymore.
Feel that energy. No.
Conch is gone.
No. Feel that energy coming from the conch. Because I can hear words of wisdom now.
Hey, maybe that's God telling you to go into Iraq.
Yeah, we're not the God of the Bible. And, before I forget, everything you bubble-headed boobies in America, have been told about trickle-down economics is a lie, it's a fantasy, it never happened. Reagan was full of shit. All Republicans are lying to you. There is no trickle-down. You hear that 2016 Republican clown bus? Trickle down is a lie. What you have is siphon up to the top 20%. The devil's economics. Siphon up economics. There is no trickling down and there won't be. Corporations are not the job creators in the United States. They will outsource everything. They will screw you. They will enslave you. All right, I'm talking slow because I want them to absorb these facts, this knowledge.
They don't do it.
But they're too...
They are incorrigible. Even God has given up on them.
That's true.
Absolutely true.
That's true, and I bet they don't even...
They will have to come around again, in other words, be resurrected right. As humans, when the devil is not around to influence them.
Yeah, well,
God can get at their mind.
Well, see, now the conservative right-wing evangelicals like the crazy Mike Huckabee, they use the Bible as a front.
Yeah.
Same thing with TV evangelists like Joel Osteen. They use the Bible as a front.
Yeah, but I just said before, remember, I gave in the latest God Project that all you have to do is go check all the scriptures given. And you will see that they are myths. They are four myths that do not come from the Bible, but they do come from tradition and man. And the Bible says, do not ever listen to a man, only God.
Well, not only that, the Republicans are guilty of idolatry because they worship money. They put money first. Now, in Matthew.
And they want to put the Ten Commandments in every courtroom.
Now, and. Oh, yeah, that's another thing Huckabee wants to do. He wants to replace the U.S. Constitution with the Bible, but they don't know the Bible.
Bingo, that's my point.
Number one, they don't know the Bible. Number two, the God they worship is not the God of the Bible.
Bingo.
Proven. Number three, there's a reason why our founding fathers wanted to keep church and state separate.
Because church is a troublemaker.
It's been a troublemaker throughout the history of mankind. It is also an unproven ideology.
It is a belief.
It is a belief which is based on a faith. Faith is hope, I guess, wishful thinking, like Bill Morrow tells me. But the point is, the Constitution is a time-proven, wonderful, successful system based on real freedom versus an unproven ideology that they don't even know. I mean, they don't even know the Bible.
Bingo.
And they want to make it the law of the land.
Bingo.
But anyway, I want to throw a little uncensored. No. I want to do a little Chiseler's Hall of
Shame.
Chiseler's Hall of Shame. Yeah. Because we are also consumer advocates, among many things. Shame on you. We're going to get back to the food service business. Pizzerias. Shame on you. Napoli Pizza in Lodi, New Jersey. And I found out all the pizzerias are doing this. All the pizzerias are doing this. And this is also tied into the American restaurant industry with everything they do, with screwing their waiters and waitresses out of a minimum wage, giving them $2 and change an hour. What the hell is it? $2.15 an
Something
hour?
Like that, yeah.
Because they get tips. But in this case, we want to stick to we want to stick to pizzerias.
Yeah,
we want to stick to the delivery people.
Charge.
Now, they charge. Last time I mentioned pizzerias, I was discussing the fact that they charge a $2 delivery fee, which does not go to the driver.
Right.
They pocket the money.
Yeah.
It's like a cover charge. Oh, you can come into my bar, my nightclub, but you have to pay $7 to get in. And then if you ask them, well, do I get a drink or beer?
No.
They go, no, you just, that's just so you come in.
Right.
That sounds fair.
All
so anyway, you have the $2 delivery charge, the fee, doesn't go to the driver, okay? The driver gets a very, very rock bottom low base salary, like the waiters and waitresses, because they make money on tips.
Wow.
Now, did you know, Dr. Bill, that the pizza delivery individuals have to pay for the gas out of their own pocket to put in the vehicle that they use to deliver pizza? Now, who decided that the pizza was to be delivered? Was it the driver or the pizzeria?
Pizzeria.
The pizzeria decided, we are going to start delivering food to our customers.
And why? Yeah.
Now.
As a courtesy, no?
As a courtesy, yes, as a courtesy.
Thank you.
Now, if a pizzeria or restaurant decides to deliver to their customers, that's their choice.
Mm-hmm.
All right? Since it's their choice, they are supposed to incur the overhead, the cost of delivering, physically delivering the food.
You would think so.
You would think so. So what do? They stick the poor delivery driver with the gas money, making him pay out of his own pocket. Listen, delivery people, I hope you're getting a receipt every time you get gas and showing it to your tax man once a year. Every time you get gas, and even when it's for your own car, get a receipt. Screw the motherfuckers. The nerve of them making the delivery people pay for the gas used to deliver the pies.
We have a pizza place in Lodi called Lodi Pizza. They
Correct.
Don't deliver.
No, but I hear the delivery driver told me it's kind of a across the board rule with pizzerias that they're all charging this bullshit delivery charge, and they're making the drivers pay for the gas to deliver the pies.
Well, let's see how long they stay in business by doing that.
Right. Wow. And there's a reason, of course, there's a reason why I mentioned, that the restaurant makes the decision that they're going to deliver food to their customers.
Yeah.
Not the drivers.
No, of course not. Yeah. It's a courtesy.
It's a courtesy. So to make the driver pay for the gas is
nice.
Yeah, the cord that goes to the end of my Blackthorn shillelagh came loose. So
I would think,
anyway,
that a courtesy is as tax deductible as a fringe benefit.
Yeah.
So it ain't costing them, as far as I know.
So what they're doing is they're making the excuse that the person gets tips. And the tips can be, sky's the limit. They're using that as an excuse not to pay for the cost of delivery.
If the courtesy is a tax deduction, as are fringe benefits, they are just making more money. That's all they're doing.
Right.
Enhancing their profits.
Yeah, it's similar
it's
to the
same as when they, you know what they do? They water down the sauce. If you'll notice.
Well, bars have been caught watering down the booze, right?
Oh, yes. A good pizza will have a red sauce.
Right.
A watered down pizza, the sauce is more orange.
Did you know a bar was caught selling top shelf booze that wasn't top shelf booze? It was the
How come the customers couldn't tell the difference?
No, they got caught because there are people. Listen, if you are a person that, if you're a martini person, like William H. Morrill III, you know a Grey Goose a vodka or a top shelf vodka.
And shaken and not stirred.
From crap and shaken but not stirred. But you know your top shelf liquor.
James Bond.
You're not gonna give cheap whiskey to somebody who drinks like 25-year-old Johnny Walker Scotch.
He's gonna eventually find out.
Well, his taste buds are gonna know. Wait a minute. This is not how Johnny Walker Scotch tastes like.
Tastes like, yeah.
And getting back to waiters and waitresses and the pizza delivery. This is like the go-go dancers. The exotic dancers now have to pay the owner of the bar to work for him. They have to tip in order for the DJ
They're renting the space, yeah.
There you go. Like leasing it out.
Yeah.
Not only do they have to pay the owner to work there, they have to pay the a big, huge gratuity to the DJ to play their music.
To the band, yeah.
Years ago, an exotic dancer got paid a base salary per set. Every time she worked, she got a base salary. You know, it could have been some bars paid $75, whatever. But she got a base, and then she made tips. Now, the girl has to pay them. Why? Because the owners kind of got tipped off. They found out how much money some of these girls are making in tips, and they use that as an excuse not to pay them anymore.
Well,
and they get away with it.
And why do they get away with it? Because
no regulations.
No regulations. No union.
Listen, I had a couple grievances where in the past where I had to call the main office of the Department of Labor for New Jersey in Newark, New Jersey. I called the Newark office, and they had a very like pro-company, nonchalant attitude. The guy had an attitude with me like, oh, nothing we can do. Oh, there's nothing we can do. There's nothing you can do?
No.
Nothing you can do. Oh, really? I says to him, it's interesting how, you know, you're blowing me off like this. I said, you sound like the time I called the Garfield, New Jersey Health Department on a particular Portuguese-Spanish buffet where they were not washing and replacing the silverware. And well, the plates, they were letting people use the same one plate to go back and forth to the buffet, realizing that when you know, you scoop the food from the buffet, the people were touching
silverware.
I'm talking about the ladle. They go back, they get more food. They scoop it, and they're ting, ting, ting.
On their plate.
And
yeah,
the ladle plate from the buffet is hitting the dirty dish.
Yeah.
They said, oh, there's no proof, there's no evidence that germs exist in that situation. Another thing, a bagel place by Pathmark in Hackensack, New Jersey. I forgot what it's called. Bagel Buffet or some ridiculous name. They were letting the girl work the register and make put the cream cheese and the whatever on the bagels. Wait a minute, that's cross-contamination.
Right.
She wasn't changing the rubber glove.
Right.
Touching money.
And food.
And then grabbing a bagel. You know what the health department in Hackensack says? Oh, there's no evidence that germs from money are any harm to food. There is no... What is this horseshit, man?
Because...
They want to get paid for doing nothing.
Well, that's what it is. They And if you really have a problem, they want you, as an individual, to go to court because you know that you ain't going to win. And you ain't got the money to do it.
For people,
so they're not doing anything.
For these people to say there's no proof to substantiate, there's no evidence to back it up. There's
nothing I can
do.
They're doing it with vaccines right now today, aren't they? It's the same argument.
No, vaccines are toxic, but
they say there's no proof.
Well, there actually is lots of proof. They just don't want to acknowledge the
bingo
proof.
But they keep saying it, don't they? And they are the officials. They are those in power.
Right. It's like if you have an asshole in charge, you will get asshole results.
So it is important, like, let's say a person is the elected president of the United States. It is a problem when he appoints corporate CEOs and etc. to handle such offices.
And his appointees to the Supreme Court are very important too. That's why
that's another matter.
You know, like let's say some seats are up and you know, well, yeah, I know, that's another matter. But there should be term limits, of course, on everybody, including the Supreme Court.
The Senate has to confirm his choices. They can always shoot them all down.
Yeah. Right. Okay. But that's a very good point. That deserves 5 rings, Dr. Bill.
Come in.
Concierge or bellhop, where's my... Could someone please take my bags? Now listen, anytime I ever went on vacation, I'm not lazy. I carry my own luggage because, first of all, then I don't have to tip the bellhop. But secondly, I don't need my luggage carried. My luggage is not that heavy and numerous. You know what I mean? To me, it's not. You know, maybe to other people, but anyway. It's my new prop. For those that can't see it. The new addition to Uncensored Hard-Hitting Truth. Okay. Let us sink our teeth into these readings. And I'm sure there's a lot of sinking to do. Oh, by the way, old Crisco Krispy Kreme Chris Christie seems he doesn't have a fond, positive opinion on Social Security.
Why, he wants to change it.
Like
he wants to raise the retirement age, etc.
They were saying Social Security is going bankrupt.
They always say that.
Which is a lie.
You know, Mr. George W. Bush actually said that U.S. Treasury bonds are worthless when he was president. They happen to be the safest investment in the whole wide world.
Then why would the country of China buy so many of them?
That's correct. They got their money in them.
Mm-hmm.
The
a lie.
Social Security system is invested in U.S. Treasury bonds to the extent of $2.7 trillion.
So it's Social Security
now
is a solid rock of Gibraltar right now.
As long as the U.S. Treasury bonds remain the safe investment.
But
however, you might want to ask, where did that money go?
Some
that
of it
was invested into Treasury bonds.
Some of it was
after
taken,
that happened,
stolen.
Where did that money go?
Did one of the Republican presidents kind of like take it to pay for...
No, it was taken to put into the general fund. It was paid for everything. It was used to pay for everything, such as the military, etc.
But that money you might as well say was stolen, because that money is not an entitlement. It belongs to we the people. It is bought and paid for by we the people. So therefore, if a Republican politician takes it and puts it into the general funds, they are stealing from the people.
What did Al Gore bitch about? A lockbox. We want Social Security in a lockbox.
Kind of like a...
They want that money out of, you know, so it cannot be stolen.
It's kind of like taking the money that is earned from a child, a child actor, a star, and putting in a trust fund. You're locking up all the money until the child turns 18. It is a trust fund.
Well, all the Republican governors are stealing the money from their pension systems in their states, as Mr. Kreme did in New Jersey.
This is very important for Bernie Sanders and Hillary Clinton to bring all of this up and expose them, if the corporate whore media allows them to say it. I'm sure, you know, once they're being interviewed, they're going to say what they want to say.
But the Republicans like that because they believe that the people working for the government, state and otherwise, are the problems. They are the problems. Okay?
Well, you know what?
So they like that.
Besides...
When we're taking away their money.
Besides complete moron teabaggers in this country, there are also moron idiotic Democrats who just think Hillary Clinton is the greatest thing that ever happened. And this includes these man-hating feminists... That are obsessed with getting a woman into the White House, and got men too that just like Hillary. And
well,
hey,
that's why we never get any reform. Any change.
They keep on voting for corporatists within the two-party system. They don't. They cannot see the truth of corporatism in the two-party system.
No.
Or corruption in the two-party system, and just say, look, I'm going to go with an independent like Bernie Sanders because the two-party system are made up of corporatists, sellouts. The media is made up of corporatists, sellouts. Let me do the right thing. Let me do the smart thing and go with a Bernie Sanders. Oh, no. They just want that Hillary Clinton in the White House. Mm-hmm. They want that woman in the White House because... You know, they might have had fond memories of when Bill was president, not realizing that Bill was a corporatist. Bill Clinton, despite how good the economy was under him, he sold out together with Newt Gingrich, and made poor people. Have really a much tougher life as far as welfare goes. He changed the welfare system because he listened to Newt Gingrich, and he wanted to compromise in a bipartisanship manner with Newt Gingrich. Now, do you see why I hate the words bipartisanship compromising? That's a perfect example on the damage
you can
do. Well,
when it's working that way, it's no good.
Well,
in our government, without compromise, you don't get nothing done.
Oh, so you want to compromise with a Republican?
No, I just said that. That was the wrong way to do it. But look back in history and see that there were compromises made so that there were reforms, so that we could get ahead, so we could progress.
Progress.
We don't have a dictatorship.
They're anti-science. They're climate change deniers.
Well, that's
They're anti-human and civil rights.
Yeah, but that's now.
I mean, to compromise with the Republican of today is like telling Satan, you know what, Satan? I'm tired of running things. Why don't you run the United States?
He's already running it.
You know, that's true. Well, yeah, Jesus. if you're a corporatist and a sellout, you're automatically in league.
You've been influenced, man. You're deceived.
Yeah, yeah.
Of course.
Yeah, it's not like you're compromising with Dwight D. Eisenhower.
But the point of it is, and for compromise to work, you got to get rid of these people that you're talking about. You got to get rid of them.
Change the system, man.
Change the system and change the people in it.
Clean out the barn, like H. Ross Perot used to say. You got to clean out the barn.
Man, clean out the stink, man.
Yeah, I'll see there, son. I'll see. Oh, okay, that's it. Let's sink our teeth into these readings.
Let's think about why many politicians want to cut extremely good programs and not encourage, in thought or in legislation, new and innovative programs such as Medicare for All. Every privatization of a government program creates the chance for a business to help fund the next campaign of some politician. No politician wants to admit those facts, except U.S. Senator Bernie Sanders.
That's right, hear, hear.
So to those with the mad as hell and don't want to take it anymore attitude, check the facts, as well as the changes Sanders would like to make. Those changes would affect your life for the better.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. A single-payer universal health care and education as a right has been working...
Oh, there is a lot to do.
...has been working splendidly in Northern Europe and Scandinavian countries for years, as well as their tax system on the rich.
But if you're living in a country like America who wants to only allow the elites to go to school to get the education so that they can get the businesses, it doesn't work.
No, they only want the children of the elites to be smart. Yeah. They want to dumb down the population, so they want to dumb you down mainstream, and they want you to be stupid so you become desperate. And you take anything, and you live in a cardboard box or a treehouse or a tent, or you hang yourself up by a street lamp or whatever the fuck you do.
And then you get rousted by the cops and get shot.
Or you get rousted by the cops and you get put into a privatized prison for providing slave labor to corporations.
Prison for profit.
Prison for profit.
There you go.
There are people out there that deny all of these facts.
Oh, yes, I know of course, them. Because anybody who goes to prison or is rousted by the cops is certainly not innocent.
Well, if
that's what they believe.
If you're homeless, you're demonized, you're considered a lazy bum, you're considered subhuman, you're ignored, people walk over you. Oh, yeah. You're an outcast.
They allow you to be swallowed by a python.
Yeah, like in India, this python swallowed this homeless wino. Drunken guy was out like a light and nobody did anything while the python swallowed him.
Did you see that post up there last night on Facebook about that anaconda?
That's one Republican way to get rid of the homeless.
Supposedly ate 257 people and a lot of animals and everything. Gigantic anaconda. I don't know.
Had to go through that many people before they decided to shoot it?
I don't know.
Did they hunt it down?
I don't know if it's true. You know, I mean, you got to be careful of posts on the internet.
In every imaginable subject, there is information on the internet that are what I call fish stories.
Uh-huh.
It was embellished, exaggerated stories. Everything is like that. Some of them are just a Photoshop fakes.
Mm-hmm.
Even some beautiful scenic photos are doctored up by, colorized by Photoshop. So there's a lot of fake stuff out there, but I'm not I'm not promoting mainstream media on television by any means. That, those are just partial to half-truths and secrets being kept from you. Pretty much. They, instead of telling you the truth, they just, you know, they just won't. They'll tell you something stupid. Something trivial. You know. Anyway.
The editorial Voting Rights concludes that requiring voter identification discriminates against minorities, the poor, and the elderly.
Absolutely.
The editorial also claims that voter fraud is seen as being almost non-existent. But my concern is not addressed. If someone who has no legal right to vote does vote and cancels my vote,
you're an American citizen. You should automatically...
Be careful.
I don't believe in nonsense.
Be careful. I know what you're going to say.
This,
and I disagree.
This is the only ID that should be required to vote in the United States. A digital photo ID from the Department of Motor Vehicle is in the form of a driver's license or a standard ID that can be acquired from your state's Division of Motor Vehicle, but people should not have to pay a separate fee to get a voter ID. This is voter suppression.
Poll tax.
It's a poll tax, like Justin Dana Spears says. It's nothing but a poll tax.
Yeah.
That's
not a poll cat now, it's a poll tax.
Right, and it is a way of suppressing votes.
Correct.
For the
Democrats.
The Democrats or the progressive...
Independents.
Liberal independents.
Whatever.
Right, it takes away votes. It gives votes to the corporatist right-wingers when you do that.
And that's why they're doing it.
And what about gerrymandering? Is there a way to get rid of that?
Put Democrats in power, and then they'll gerrymander in their benefit.
Not Jerry Seinfeld or Salamander. Gerrymandering.
That's what it's all about. The people in power get the gerrymander.
The district. The districts are like preset. Now, what did you think I was going to say?
What you've been saying lately.
About what?
Before.
I was...
You're in favor of voter ID. But you don't go and continue that statement wherein it costs money.
Oh, no, I don't... I never felt that the poor should pay an additional fee to vote in the United States. You have a right. You have a God-given or a constitutional right that if you're legally living in the United States, you should be able to vote.
However, the states are in power about that.
It's not a federal...
No.
Okay.
So, you know, if they decide that they want you to have an ID, well, that's what they're doing.
I mean...
If you get a goddamn Republican governor, that's what they're doing.
It's a given. Anybody who is either born in the United States or... is legal, a legal alien, I hate to use that word, is a legal immigrant who has the proper papers.
Naturalized citizen. There you go.
Not synthetic citizen, not GMO citizen, but a naturalized citizen should be able to automatically vote in every election.
Yeah.
And only requiring the basic ID. Because in order for me to get this ID for motor vehicle, I had to show my original birth certificate, proof of address, social security card. I had to show everything to get this. So if you have this, you should not need any other form of ID.
However, when you go to the polling place, they don't ask you for that.
No, they don't.
When you registered to vote,
right,
they gave you an ID.
Right.
Which your signature is on.
Yes.
And when you go to the polling place, and you talk to the lady with the book.
She looks up your name.
She looks up your name, and you have given her that card.
And you sign it.
That ID.
You sign it.
You have given the ID, you sign the book, and you sign a little paper that she gives you.
Right.
To take into the booth and then come out, and she gets the paper.
And then there's the person.
So they have already given you an ID.
There is the voter booth tender. There is somebody that tends.
A woman at the tent, yes.
Well, it could be man too.
Man too.
That tends the voting booth. That takes the slip, the stub, from your hands, and then you go in and vote.
So how the hell is there voting fraud? And how the hell do we need another ID? We don't.
No. All right.
Anyone claiming that fraudulent votes represent a small number of the total and could not influence an election is ignoring history. Of the 101,455,899 votes cast in the 2000 presidential election between Al Gore and George W. Bush, 537 votes decided the outcome. Well, he's wrong there, isn't he?
Yeah.
It was the 5-4 decision of the United States Supreme Court who decided the outcome. Florida would have gone to Al Gore, and he would have been president if there were only 538 fraudulent votes cast for him.
Florida with Jebby at the helm.
That election, yeah, but now it's your, whatchamacallit, pinhead.
Oh, the Q-tip head or the dick-headed Rick Scott.
Yeah.
Rick Scott, the man who wants to arrest you if you feed the homeless.
Yeah.
And if you're a homeless person living in a tent, he wants to evict you from the woods.
That election alone proves that every vote cast must be legitimate. To make getting a voter ID excuse-proof, expand access to the application process. Any facility that serves the public could be licensed to generate voter ID applications. Pharmacies, supermarkets, public libraries, firehouses, police stations, and the like could process the applications and forward them to the issuing agency. The elderly should remain exempt because they would have legitimate reasons that may still make it difficult to obtain a voter ID.
Yes, and people that physically can't get to the polls should be able to vote absentee, ballot.
All Western democracies require voter ID. Why are we alone in putting our democracy at risk by not protecting the integrity of our elections? Now, what did I just say before? We already have voter IDs.
Yes.
When we registered.
Yes. So, well, how these Republicans get away with all these scams, all these schemes and scams and underhanded tactics, it's amazing.
If we don't, we risk experiencing the stolen elections common in banana republics.
That reading deserves 7 bells. Excellent. I think I'm going to love this new prop.
Let me see if I have something small here. Because
it's time to feed my starving. It's almost time for lunch. And I brought something for myself, too.
Oh, wonderful.
I brought 3 curried hard-boiled eggs.
Ooh.
With imported spicy Indian curry on it. Curry in a hurry, I call it.
Bowing to public outcry, The Indian government said on Tuesday that it would lift a days-old ban on hundreds of pornographic websites.
A ban? Oh, so they're real strict about... this is a country that bangs out a lot of babies. How many people are in India? Over a billion?
Around 1.2 billion or so.
So, and they also tend to like to gang rape their women in...
On buses
and every which way. So they're like... but they don't like pornography. And what about the Kama Sutra, the infamous Kama Sutra? That's Indian.
After critics accused the government of encroaching on personal freedom.
Yeah, that's censorship. Banning porn is a censorship.
Over the weekend, Indian authorities ordered internet providers to block 857 websites deemed to carry pornographic material.
They care about that, but the Indian government sure let Monsanto come in with its genetically modified seeds.
Saying the ban was needed to protect public morality.
Protect the morality, but poison your people with GMOs. Monsanto GMO crops.
But the order drew outrage and ridicule.
As it should.
Particularly after many of the websites were found not to feature pornography. And even Indian officials acknowledged that the ban could be subverted by readily available internet tools. Information and Technology Minister Ravi Shankar Prasad said late Tuesday that the ban will be partially withdrawn.
What an asshole.
And that only sites that carry child pornography would remain blocked.
Well, that I agree 100%. So, that was the small one, right? Okay, I just want to say, give greetings to my near dear friend from Osaka, Japan, Miho. Hello, Miho. And to all my Facebook group administrators. Greetings. And also to my friend in the state of Oregon, the president and owner of Bugs in Cyberspace, Mr. Peter Clausen. I give a shout out to you. A true bugiologist, an expert at bugs, insects, anything that crawls, anything that crawls, he's an expert at, and a connoisseur. Well, I'm not saying he eats them, but he can if he wanted to, but you know, that's another talk show. But anyway, now it is time for our gastronomic delight known as lunch, and we will go now to how to defeat a conservative Bible quotes. Just simply pause and read and hopefully learn. Followed by our commercial voiceover artist, William Hamilton Moore III, with his words of wisdom and promo. Five bells for William Hamilton Moore. Super dynamic, brother. We are super dynamic. Thank you.
Hi, this is William H. Morrow. The best way to join our organization is to get your free annual subscription to Newsletter Censored with your gift to support this work. The newsletter of hard-hitting truth and news fighting censorship and conservative propaganda since 1977. There is nothing out there like the Newsletter Censored in the mainstream media or the press. This newsletter is the very best way to join and be a part of our organization. We're living the end times, so you need Newsletter Censored. Go to www.newslettercensored.com. Hey, listen. For the real hard-hitting truth, you need Newsletter Censored. And now, back to the show. Bye-bye.
Okay, we're back. Thank you very much, William Hamilton, Morrow the Third, for doing promo, as always. Now we return for the balance of our weekly show on Censored Hard-Hitting Truth.
All right, now.
Capitalism in a conch show. Don't forget, brother. Capitalism in a conch show.
Maybe some people do not acknowledge or know this, but yeah. Eggs prices have gone out of sight. However,
extremely high.
However,
prices.
Some owners and businesses are not raising the price. They are taking it on the chin.
You mean breaking?
But most places.
Breaking out even, maybe?
But most places are raising the price.
Now, what has caused this to take place?
Bird flu.
Oh.
Wherein. I forget the number, but it was somewhere like 40 some million chickens were killed.
In the U.S.?
Were killed.
The bird flu made its appearance in the United States?
Whatever.
There is no whatever. It's usually in Asia.
Well, they killed them here either because it was here or because they were protecting that it did not get here. One or the other. Okay?
I really feel sorry for the chicken as an animal. I really do.
A chicken in every pot.
I mean, from the time they were hatched.
But what would happen if you allowed all chickens to just continue to breed?
Be too many chickens.
Yeah.
Bacak!
Yeah.
I mean, chicken. If you look at it, if you look at some of the colorful breeds of chicken, you know, and the fighting the fighting roosters, and if you look at them, and they can be some of them quite beautiful birds, you know what I mean, and they have personalities. They're fun to watch. I've watched chickens interact. They're not. Well, hell, pigs are considered livestock food, and pigs made the top 10 list of most intelligent animals, and we kill them for meat, right? So
anyway, in any case, as I said, some businesses are reluctant to raise the price. I didn't raise my prices at all. Kind of hurting my bottom line, but I'm just waiting out the market, said Chris Coldon, owner of the bagel store in Carlstadt, New Jersey.
You know how many customers would be pissed off if he raised his price of eggs to, let's say, $4 a dozen? He would have to explain to countless customers why. He doesn't want to deal with that.
He said he doesn't plan on raising prices because people people pay enough for stuff already.
True.
At Chiller's Grill in Fort Lee, known for its breakfast items such as its four-egg omelet, the rising cost of eggs has cut into profits. But the business said it won't be raising prices. We cannot raise the prices on the customers because they won't understand, said Nick Pappas, manager. The restaurants just have to eat the costs and make less profit. Some businesses are scrambling
levity belts
to adjust to the egg shortage by changing ingredients. Rita's Italian Ice.
I know the company.
Which has at least 7 locations in Bergen and Passaic counties. Said last month it transitioned from using custard in its products to eggless soft serve ice cream.
Yeah, Rita's Italian Ice, I believe it's a Philadelphia based company. You know, little pricey, small portions. I'm not a fan, but you know.
According to a notice on the company's website, the adjustment was made due to a nationwide egg shortage. Other businesses were forced to raise their prices for items with egg ingredients.
Exactly.
The cafeteria at 1 Garrett Mountain Plaza in Woodland Park posted a sign for customers that read, "Due to the extreme increase in our egg prices, we've had to raise our breakfast items accordingly." That meant an extra charge of 25 cents per sandwich.
Go on.
An employee at the Meadowlands Diner in Karlstadt, who did not want to give her name, said the 24-hour diner had to raise prices to chagrin of the patrons.
There's nothing wrong with her statement.
We changed our menus and prices went up and customers aren't happy.
Of course they're not.
Experts say consumers should brace themselves for egg prices to continue to rise.
Continue, huh?
Like a cheese souffle. Especially as the holiday season approaches. My daughter's cakes in Dumont.
That's the name of the place?
That's correct.
What a stupid name.
Said, if prices continue to increase, the store may be forced to push prices up, especially as their busy season approaches.
Doing so will be very excruciating.
It's an awful thing to go through, especially in the work that I do, said Denise Smith, owner of the cake business that specializes in wedding cakes. She said she has yet to make any adjustments, but in the future, she may have to.
And her customers will not be in ecstasy.
The spike the spike in egg prices has inadvertently benefited other customers. Sweet Avenue Bake Shop, a Rutherford-based vegan bakery, does not use any egg products.
Yeah, they're vegan. Yeah, I think the replacement for eggs is like flaxseed meal, and there are certain.
How about sour cream?
Well, vegan. Vegans don't.
Sour cream and.
No, not for vegan. They don't want dairy. No animal source.
Well, so. For other people, sour cream and regular fluffed up cream.
Yeah. Well.
Whipped cream.
I know in vegan baking, they usually recommend. Some people use applesauce, but most use like a flaxseed flour or flaxseed meal as an egg substitute, because when it gets wet, the flaxseed meal has a very slimy, you know, egg-like consistency. It's
less of them.
If it's soy lecithin, I guess that's okay. Sure. Lecithin granules?
According to co-owner Jake Vance, the business has seen a slight spillover from customers reacting to rising prices at other local bake shops. We've heard some people mention it, he said. It's kind of indirectly benefiting us. National chains that rely on eggs to boost their bottom lines are adjusting as well. Denny's is pushing burgers instead of omelets, while Dunkin' Donuts is advertising smoothies and iced coffees. Panda Express has swapped in corn for the eggs in its fried rice.
Oh. Really?
Really.
Corn is not an Asian vegetable. Corn is from the Americas. I think it's not applicable to use corn.
Well, they are doing it.
Well, they're not supposed to. Same thing with peppers, not black pepper, but, you know, capsicum peppers are from the New World, and Chinese takeout restaurants or whatever, they use peppers too in their stir fry. They shouldn't do it, it's not Asian. Carrots, another thing.
It's not kosher.
No, it's not kosher. Carrots are another known. The carrots. You know what's funny? I saw a photo from an organic farm of carrots coming in all different beautiful colors.
Oh, yeah.
Same thing with cauliflower. It doesn't just come
in white.
No. It comes in purple and green. Same thing with potatoes. There's hundreds of different varieties of potatoes. Over in where they come from, the Andes Mountains of South America, Ecuador, Peru, different colors. It's people. So many Americans are living in sort of a culinary prison. They don't know what's out there. The real adventure of natural food, a variety.
I'm a meat and potato guy.
You eat like.
Period.
You eat like my friend Brian Slate. He can eat grilled chicken breasts and broccoli on the side.
No broccoli.
Every friggin' day. No, I mean, like, in other words, He eats very
mono,
simple,
uh-huh,
the same friggin' food all the time. If you give him Mexican, he says, I don't want this spicy shit.
This crap.
Same thing with you. Well, it's crap to you.
I don't want no tacos, no chalupas, no burritos.
It's crap to
burritos.
You. But,
no, not.
But for me to eat bland food, I couldn't do it. To me, that's crap. It's boring. To you, it's fine. You see how different people are? People are... I'm telling you, the human race is a strange lot.
We're individuals.
It makes no sense to eat bland and the same thing all the time.
Well, you eat for fuel. That's the number one reason to eat. Not to look pretty on a plate, and et cetera.
I don't eat spicy food from India or Thailand or Mexico because it's pretty looking. I eat it because I want an adventure for my taste buds.
But the French make a big obsession about putting an artistic painting on your plate.
Well, that's an elitist way of thinking, though.
Jesus.
That's an elitist because they want to be artists so they can use that as an excuse to give you tiny portions.
Regarding Christie joins the hopefuls in trial run for GOP debate.
Yeah.
As the saying goes, elections have consequences. Should Governor Christie ever get his name on a future federal or state level ballot, every teacher and his or her extended family members should remember his line about punching the teachers' union in the face and vote accordingly.
Well, I think unions should grow a spine like they did in the old days and possibly punch him in the stomach.
Despite his lengthy history of perversely derogatory comments, this one may sink to a new pathetic low. If teachers made public comments along these lines, their jobs would be at risk, and they certainly would be disciplined. Christie evidently does not understand that bullying and violence have no place in the classroom or our communities, and he should offer his apology, even if he can't walk back this remark.
I'm telling you, the union leaders have to get tough and play hardball with this guy. I can do it. You got to be tough. Yeah. How do you deal with?
Then you have to start a union.
How do you deal with a bully? You hit him in the balls. You hit him below
the
belt.
Huh? Punch him in the nose.
You know, that reminds me of a very wise saying that came from Mike Tyson.
Tyson made a... oh my God.
It's simple, but it makes a lot of sense. And this is it. Everyone has a plan until they get hit in the face. Everyone has a plan.
Oh boy. Perhaps he should be forced to repeat that statement in Newtown, Connecticut, and tell it like it is in front of their entire grieving community. Such recent stories on climate change, global warming, as Pope Francis's environmental encyclical Michael and President Obama's greenhouse gas reduction plan for power plants have garnered needed attention, but also misinformation.
Pope Francis is a cool dude. I really dig that guy. 7 rings for Pope Francis. Continue.
Throughout our planet's 4.3 billion years, it has cooled and warmed time and again.
Yeah, yeah.
Without help from humans.
Yeah, so they want to get big oil off scot-free.
NASA scientists show from evidence left in the environment that greenhouse gases stretch back more than 800,000 years.
Is this like conservative scientific propaganda, perhaps?
Climate change! Skeptics are absolutely correct in this fact.
Oh, really?
However, they either do not know or choose to forget that the climate warming we are now experiencing is occurring at a much more rapid rate than past warming events, and that speed is being caused by human activity.
Well, the fluorocarbons put out by big oil into the atmosphere.
According to NASA, the average Earth surface temperature will rise by 5 to 7 degrees Fahrenheit by the end of the 21st century.
Of course, destroying, cutting down the rainforest for profit, out of greed, doesn't help.
There was a gentleman on a post on Facebook who bought, what was it, $12 million or something?
Many acres of to preserve it as is.
Yeah.
Untouched.
So they wouldn't cut it down.
Untouched the rainforest. I mean, wouldn't it be great if many intelligent, good-hearted, rich people would do the same? You know,
you're making a big mistake, pal.
Who else is going to buy thousands of acres?
Until proven otherwise, there are no decent rich people.
Maybe he uses it as a tax write-off.
Maybe, that is correct.
Maybe he needs a tax. What about what's that actor again? Not Lawrence Fishburne, the other one.
Black one?
Older black gentleman.
I know who you mean.
Morgan Freeman?
Morgan Freeman.
He purchased acres to use as a bee sanctuary.
Yes.
I'm sure he's writing this purchase off.
Yes.
As I said,
until proven otherwise, no rich man or woman
does things
is good
out of the goodness of their heart. There's always a catch, is what you're trying to say.
Has the Earth moved out of the ice ages? Global temperatures rose a total of 5 degrees over 5,000 years. In the previous century alone, the temperature has climbed 1.53 degrees. Roughly more than 10 times faster than the average rate of ice age recovery warming. This rate of change is extremely unusual. climate warming happening much faster now, many species, including humans, will not be able to adapt quickly enough.
Everybody would have to buy cross-country skis and snowmobiles.
This only planet of ours, with all its diversity and magnificent natural beauty,
Kaput,
was a gift given to us because of our Maker's love for us. Let's try and not spoil that love. John Muir once said, every rock, plant, and living thing is a window opening into heaven, a mirror reflecting the Creator.
Well, he was thinking of the original Garden of Eden. If he knew if he knew about the food chain that goes on in these beautiful parts of the world that look like paradise, of predator versus prey and all this stuff, you can't beat Mother Nature, the beauty of it, the importance of it, the importance of vegetation, overlooked tremendously. This day and age, with all the construction and the strip malls and the big shopping malls and the parking lots and roads and highways, and every tree removed and every piece of vegetation removed is less oxygen and more carbon dioxide put into the atmosphere, and also soil erosion, because the roots of plants hold moisture, hold the soil together, shade, absorbing heat from the sun. All this is important.
Why should anyone be surprised that three health care insurers are asking the state to approve double-digit price hikes for 2016. But this must surely come as a surprise and a shock to the many people who believe the spin that the Affordable Care Act was really revenue neutral. In a private healthcare system, when the government decides to provide health care for tens of millions of people, the money has to come from somewhere.
Yeah, and I hear there are still lots of Americans that remain uninsured.
Well, there are several states who did not allow the exchanges to exist in their state.
On purpose.
Or take the Medicaid
expansion.
Out of spite.
For the Democratic black man in the White House.
Yeah. And to keep those poor people poor.
So they use that as an excuse to say that Obamacare is a disaster and doesn't work. They use that as an excuse, but they created that by not accepting.
Yes. In a private healthcare system, when the government decides that the money must come from somewhere, and it certainly won't be coming from the private insurers, the American Care, the Affordable Care Act, Obamacare, okay? Obamacare, which President Obama negotiated with those private health care insurers.
Yeah, it's a compromise.
Has increased the profits of those insurers.
Another compromise.
With tens of millions of new customers. And the rest of us will be increasingly picking up the bill.
Yeah, well...
To put that in perspective, the share price of the United Health Group, the largest health insurer, was 30.40 cents on March 23, 2010. The day the president signed Obamacare, since then the company's price per share has increased an astonishing 375%.
You notice the Republican debate mentioned Hillary Clinton quite a bit, but they did not really say Bernie Sanders at all.
Well, they're shaking.
I think they're shaking.
They're being like
CNN.
They don't want to mention them at all.
I think they're shaking and they're shivering in their timbers.
I saw today on CNN.
Yeah, about Bernie.
A group was being interviewed. There were three conservatives.
Yeah.
The whole group was conservatives.
Yeah.
On CNN.
Really?
Yeah.
I don't like CNN and I don't like MSNBC. Boycott MSNBC. They are sellout corporate whores.
But rising health care premiums are not the only problem for Americans. Deductible costs have risen to a point where many middle-class Americans can no longer afford necessary medical procedures and are skipping them. A recent Commonwealth Fund survey found that 4 in 10 working age adults skipped some kind of health care because of costs. The problem is that at some point, those skipped health care procedures will become dangerous and costly emergencies. So health care should definitely be provided for all Americans, but it can never be cost effective in a private health care system. It can only be cost-effective in a single payer or a Medicare for all system.
Yeah, universal health care. And I would like to give...
Socialism! It's socialism! You're talking socialism!
Socialism number one! Number one! For the people! Pro little guy, socialism, number one. Bernie Sanders, number one. I'm doing Iron Sheik.
Number one. Bernie Sanders, number one.
Number one.
Socialism, number one. Conservatives, capitalism, ah, poo.
Seven rings for that reading.
I am 21.
Good for him or her.
And on my second marriage.
What? What? Two marriages by age 21? This person hasn't really... Ooh,
My husband of 2 years is every girl's dream man.
Oh, that's what they all say. You know what? I bet if you took a look at all those ex-boyfriends that Taylor Swift is crying about, they probably look like dirtbags instead of real men.
The kindest, gentlest, most patient guy.
The world's smallest violin.
He loves me for everything. Including my flaws.
Oh, sure. He...
I honestly believe he's the only one who could ever handle me.
She's a pain in the ass.
So tell me, why am I cheating on him?
Oh, she's cheating. She thinks so highly of him, but she's cheating on him. What did I say before about human beings being fucked up beyond recognition, beyond belief? I mean, she's cheating. After all these accolades, she's cheating on him.
I never thought that I could find myself in this situation. I have a lot happening in my life.
She's too young.
But there is no excuse for why I am straying from such an amazing husband.
Because you're only 21. You shouldn't have gotten married so young. What did I say at the beginning?
I love him.
Yeah, you love him. Lust after him. What does she know about love and life at 21?
But when I get a text, I hope so badly that it's from the other man.
I don't know, man. I think they're both fools for getting married so young. I think he's the biggest fool not knowing this about her.
And when it's from my husband, I feel disappointed.
He's the greatest find she ever made. A lot of logic there.
We see the other man. He works for my parents. This situation is messy, and I don't know what to do. I can't tell my husband. It would ruin his life. I'd rather just leave him without giving any reason than to tell him the truth. I want to leave him and live my own life.
Bonesy is starting to dance.
But I'm afraid to be on my own. I don't know why I stay. I'm lost and confused. Can I have some advice, please?
I'm glad I'm not a shrink.
Dear Reckless.
Reckless. Lunatic.
You're playing at matrimony as if it were a game instead of a deep, enduring partnership.
And that is part of her youth, that she's too young.
Staying married to someone because you're afraid to be on your own is doing both of you a disservice.
No, people are not taking their marriage or their marriage vows seriously. It's a game to them.
If you think leaving your husband for no reason would be less hurtful than telling him the truth, you are mistaken.
It's like a teenage teenage girls saying, I want to have a baby, they're so cute. I want to have a puppy, they're so cute, you know?
Can I have those little peepees, mommy, for Easter?
Yeah, little chicks. Oh, they're so adorable. Oh, the bunny is adorable. They don't look at...
Mommy, remember the peepee we got yesterday? He's dead.
Yeah, because...
I was playing with it. He's dead.
Yeah, or maybe the child or the pet was neglected because the person selfishly wasn't... impulsively want to acquire it, procure it, without doing any research, without realizing what's best for the child or the pet.
You owe it to him to be level with
gosh, the poor guy.
About the affair, so he won't blame himself for your leaving.
What
do you do? I strongly recommend that you get counseling from a licensed mental health professional to help you slow down and more carefully consider what you're doing before you marry for a third time.
That's very sound advice. You know, of course, the way she's presenting it doesn't make sense. She starts off by really building this guy up sky high, and then she lowers the boom that she's been cheating with, I guess, a co-worker or something, or an employee of her parents. She is just too young. Wasn't it a song by Gary Puckett in the Union Gap?
And she probably
young
has
girl, that, get it out of my mind.
What? She probably has that woman thingy, wherein they always go for the bad boy.
Yeah, they go for men, boyfriends that their parents would hate.
Yeah.
The more the parents disapprove of the man, the more they like would love him.
Yeah.
And if they brought a boyfriend home to meet the parents, and the parents just adore the guy, he's gone. She'll dump him.
1, 2, 3.
I know this for a fact. Yeah, they rebellion is what a young human is all about. Me, I don't have any tolerance for bullshit, so, you know, I'm glad I don't have any kids. You know, I don't have any tolerance for stupid people, foolish people, imbeciles.
Suffer me not those fools. African lions.
Oh, here, I know where this is going.
Are iconic fixtures in Western civilization's collective consciousness.
A magnificent animal, the male lion. Yes.
They symbolize many romantic aspirations, nobility, strength, courage, majesty, and steadfast fidelity.
Yeah.
L. Frank Baum's Cowardly Lion of Oz realized the scripted version of his lion essence to become Dorothy's fierce protector hero.
Yeah, the male lion with the mane and everything is an iconic symbol since ancient times. That is true. My astrological sign, too.
The symbolism also suggests We might be something more than ordinary, fearful and complacent cowards. Often humanity's default condition. We are occasionally called out by the lion-hearted, those who overcome our fears and reach for what might be. The dentist on safari, who allegedly hired an ever-dwindling number of living icons away from protected sanctuaries and paid $50,000 to do so, offers zero inspirational symbolism.
Yeah, well, rich big game hunters, wealthy big game hunters that feel the need to do what he did are obviously lacking in masculinity. They're insecure in their masculinity. There is no logical reason to hunt for the thrill, for the sport, aside from food, the acquisition of meat.
The dentist was inspired by narcissism. And his Zimbabwean enablers were inspired by the dentist anti-hero's cold, hard cat.
You know, I got a new concept for big game hunting. It's called poacher hunting. Have an open season for poachers and put a bounty on their heads. Dead or alive, like the Wild Wild West used to do, you know. Wanted, dead or alive.
Paladin.
Yeah. Paladin was Richard Boone, right?
Yeah.
Have gun, will travel.
Have gun, will travel, reads the card of a man.
He had the knight from the chess piece on his business card.
Yeah.
Your case would be the bishop.
Some 600 African lions fall to hunting tourism each year.
Oh, for God's sakes. Aren't they endangered?
I once worked with a hunter from Pennsylvania who would bait his backyard with salt licks and apples a few weeks before hunting season began.
Well, that's...
He would gradually lure deer.
Well, that's deer. There's too many of them. That's meat for the table.
Into an open field.
Yeah.
By opening day, he would have a reasonably tame herd grazing mere yards from his back porch.
Easy pickings for his rifle.
He would sit in a rocking chair next to a cooler of beer and shoot them.
And pick them off right from his back porch, right?
Like fish in a barrel.
Oh, a lot of sport in that, man. A lot of sport in that.
Nothing lion-hearted about that.
Oh, I hear you could bait wild turkey also.
Had the dentist shot a storied swamp alligator or landed a notorious great white shark, he would be far less maligned.
Why doesn't he do something useful and go out and hunt the...
He is right now. He's hiding.
Big Burmese python in the Florida Everglades. They're an invasive species. They want to get rid of them.
Cecil the lion.
Yeah, and his brother. Poor
Jericho.
Guys. Yeah.
Might have been a man-eater, too.
But because his species had been pressed into the anthropomorphic service of human imagination, we don't view lions objectively. We idealize them. Cecil has morphed into Bambi, Old Yella, Black Beauty, and Winnie the Pooh. His cruel demise, tugging at heartstrings everywhere.
Well,
lest us not forget, we can talk all around this issue. He lured the lion off his protective range and killed him. Okay?
Deliberately lured.
That's correct.
That's right.
That is correct. Never forget that part of it. Because we seem to be doing that.
Well, this man, the dentist, I consider him a poacher. I consider his accomplices equally guilty. And I hope they smoke him out. And he ends up in a Zimbabwe prison, which will be very different from an American prison, I assure you. He won't be living high on the hog, but then again, if he's got big bucks, he might. He might pay off the government of the third world and get off scot-free, perhaps.
Yeah, it depends on where they want to try him. I believe Zimbabwe does want him.
They want him, but when he starts flashing money under their nose...
There you go.
Hey, could this make you forget about Cecil and his brother? And start waving
that... Well, he had nothing to do with the brother.
Somebody else...
In fact,
else?
I believe the brother's still alive. He didn't get killed.
Oh, the brother didn't get shot? Well, then that was misinformation on the internet.
That's correct.
That is probably animal rights nuts, exaggerating.
Yeah, going too far.
You know? I mean, there are animal rights nuts, fanatics, that yell at me for consuming dairy products and for having leather boots and leather shoes and a leather wallet. And a leather belt. There are people that are nuts. And
wait a minute.
My answer
isn't
to you...
Isn't that your way of teaching?
What?
Don't you just say that you got to knock them on the head, you got to do this guy and the other thing, blah, 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 blah. Convince them they're trying to do that the same...
Well,
they're using the same tactic
there's no way I would wear vinyl belt or have a vinyl boot, Western boot.
We're talking about the method of teaching. Does that method work?
But we're
it
talking about
didn't work with you.
We're talking about fanaticism.
No, we're talking about teaching.
I am not a fanatic. I am. What I say is based on proven facts, science, and logic. I am not a fanatic. These are fanatics.
I hate to just say it, but go back to an hour ago.
Yeah.
And you were coming from a fanatic position.
No, I was, coming from a very logical position.
Concerning the Bible.
You clarified what you meant by equality to God by having the same God-like mindset was represented equality. I was looking at equality from a power standpoint. You get it?
They will have much power.
I'm sure they will.
They
will eventually go out into the universe.
But the
and begin the breeding process
aside from that, because no religion has been proven, nobody has proven that their God exists. Let's stick to vegans and animal rights activists. An animal rights activist that is an extremist fanatic is a form of ultra-liberal personality.
And is he going to teach you to go along with his way?
They don't believe
by the method he used
in the consumption of any animal products, including eggs
and
dairy.
Will his method of teaching convince you to change? That's all I'm asking.
I enjoy a steak, a hamburger.
So no is the answer.
And
that's all you needed to say.
Well, prove to me why I should give up all animal foods, animal source foods.
I asked the question. A yes or no answer is all I need.
It's different from what we debated earlier on.
A yes and no answer is all I need.
Why are you giving them the right to be an ultra fanatical, ultra liberal animal rights activist?
Not my question.
And tell me I can't have leather Western boots on my
feet. Not my question.
Why are you defending them? Because you yourself are ultra liberal.
I said, did their method of teaching change your mind? That's all I asked. Yes or no?
I say it won't change my mind because
yes or no.
They can't prove to me that
now when you tell other people your way or method and want to teach them, will they listen?
Well, my way...
Will they listen?
My way has a proven fact behind it.
If the deceived do not accept your fact, how are they going to change?
He puts too much... He gives people too much respect and value for having perceptions, perceiving things. Perception means shit if you can't prove it. I put value in science, proven facts, not ideology. I don't care if you're a multi-billionaire. If your perception is unproven, I don't hold...
How can you prove that?
About the what? Vegan?
That your method is proof,
listen,
and their method
listen.
Ain't.
Well, as far as political goes, the proof is in the pudding. We're talking about proven track records, the history, who does this benefit versus does it benefit the people, does it benefit the rich? Okay, as far as animal rights nuts, they feel sorry for the cow, which means that they don't believe that any creature should be prey and food. Okay?
But I'm not talking about that.
What you're trying to do is bust the balls of old James P. Madonna again for another Saturday. For another fucking goddamn Saturday.
Will their method...
Again.
Change your mind. That's all I ask.
No, because they don't have any proof.
Thank you.
They don't have any proof.
No is the answer.
I do.
Where?
Concerning what? Politics or animal rights activism?
Whatever.
Well, let's talk about the subject.
Whatever subject.
You either got proof or you don't.
Fox News has no proof.
Then what they have to say?
With the greatest amount of listeners
and viewers. Because these people are jerk-off, brain cell deficient morons.
So?
What do you mean, so?
How do you teach
what
that?
What if you're wrong and I can prove you're wrong? This, because
then
your
I'm
perception,
wrong.
Because you feel like disagreeing with me, that makes you right? No, it doesn't. I don't think so.
We're not talking about that. We're talking
what
about
what if I can
teaching.
Prove you're wrong? With facts.
Where? About what?
About anything. Because you perceive something, I have to respect
that. Simple question. The way those animal rights people came to you, did their method change your mind?
Fuck them.
If they want to
begrudge me from having a leather wallet in my pocket and wear and not have leather shoes, fuck them, because I don't like vinyl. I like leather.
Fine. No, their method did not work.
Because I don't. I think there's a mental illness in the ultra pandering Pollyanna liberal.
Think.
Just like there's a mental illness in the extreme right-wing person. Fanaticism is a mental illness. There is no basis for a fanatic's opinion. Your opinion, if it's based on your perception, doesn't hold any water, Charlie. Or Bill. Bill, actually.
What if you're living in a time when the opinion has not been proved? Or has, you know, I mean, if you were living in a...
Living in a pipe dream, then.
In the 1400s, quantum physics was not found out then.
Well,
there were many unanswered questions.
You know what I always wondered? Why didn't... If all the scientists that were oppressed by the stupid and corrupt Catholic Church, why didn't they move to Protestant England? They sure could have done their work over there. You know? That's proof. But getting back to the animal rights activists, they are part of ultra fanatical liberalism, just like the radical right-wingers are the other side of the fence. We're talking about nuts, fanatics.
I'm talking about teaching. I'm not talking about nuts.
Well, in order to
or
teach,
fanatics.
In order to teach, you have to have fact. You have to have facts to teach.
To teach.
You know what? You have to have, in order to be a teacher, you have to have something going for you.
You have to have a certain attitude. And I'm trying
attitude.
To impress upon you that the attitude that those animal rightsers used against you
right. Did
not work. And I'm saying in some instances, your attitude towards
you're wrong. Others, you're wrong. Your interpretation of the Bible's wrong. All right, I disagree with you. It's too goddamn bad if you don't like it.
Then you know what I'm going to tell you.
What?
Read it.
I'll read it.
No, you won't.
Tell me. Send me the verses by email.
No. You find them.
You know what? You're the type of guy that you like those ultra liberal people. You
nobody
like
said
them.
That at all. Where do you get that?
Because I get the impression, well, first of all, you're anti-death penalty and you're pro-affirmative action. So that makes you ultra-liberal right there.
Well, what the hell does that have to do with teaching?
You gotta have facts to be a good teacher. You can't have perception. You have to have something to back you up.
I just showed you that you also have to have attitude.
Why?
Because the method did not work on you from the animal rights people who came to you and said, do not eat Jerry. Do not have done boots on.
Listen, When
it didn't work.
When Dr. Gary Null went before court, and he had stacks and stacks of evidence to back up Gary Null, I say that's all a person needs because they got the evidence. So therefore, the courts that were probably paid off, corporate shills that opposed Gary, that didn't want to listen to Gary.
No, the court did not.
They didn't listen to him.
It worked in the court. It did not work in the debates.
Well, they got there are a bunch of stupid fucking nuts in the Republican.
Exactly my point, isn't it?
There were nuts. Your idea that the 144,000 resurrected elect will be equal in power to the Almighty.
It's not my idea.
It's preposterous.
It's not my idea. It's what the Bible says. Do not ever accuse me of saying anything
benefit. Equal in power.
Okay?
Equal in mind, yes. Equal in power? That's a pretty big statement.
Why?
Because you have a God who was there at the beginning with the Word, who became Jesus. They created everything.
No, they did not.
Then who created it? Elmer Fudd?
The Word created it.
I said the Word was there.
No, you said they.
I said the Word. Well, they. What do you think? All right, what role does the God have? Since God is...
The word God, translated from the Hebrew, Elohim, is a uniplural word. When you say God, you're not talking one person, you're talking two in this instance. Or you could be talking a family.
Okay.
A church.
Melchizedek. Yahweh. The Word. When the Word was there at the beginning, and he created everything, he must have had a lot going for him, because he was able to create everything. Now, how could a resurrected person, resurrected as one of the elect, how could they, I can understand them having the same mindset as the Word, but how could they be just as powerful as the Word who created everything at the beginning?
They are spirit beings just like him.
Then how do you equate the equality of power?
What equality of power? What are you talking about?
You just said it! You keep contradicting yourself!
I don't know what you're talking about!
You said that the resurrected 144,000 are equal to God in power!
They are God!
But they're not equal to him in power, with the Word. They're equal to the Word. You said that!
Father and the Word.
You know what?
Will always
be more
powerful.
That's what I said.
They are the ones who created
others. That's what I said. And you said
no,
I was wrong.
The way you said
you contradicted me before.
Because you say it wrong. You are talking in a human way of power. That's not how
God
works.
Well, the Creator is more powerful in all ways.
But how do you mean powerful? You mean it in a negative way. I'm talking positive.
Power is force, strength.
For something, not against something.
Well, they have like minds. I will agree
That's
with that.
That's why it's positive and not negative.
Here we go again. This is another ultra-liberal trait of being pacifist. Not no wars, no fighting.
So positiveness
everybody's got to live in this hippie commune and have a big loving and you know, I mean, now the whole thing of not recognizing power in terms of strength and size and force, you know, discounting that kind of power, saying it doesn't exist from the conversation.
In the millennium, as Ezekiel and right. Isaiah say, the swords shall be beaten into plowshares.
Well, that makes
they will not be thinking in terms of power as you
now
are.
do you see okay. How you change instead of course the creators is bigger and more powerful than the,
no
than
not
the
those terms please bigger stronger no
if you're using the word power. You know what? This guy
you're using it in a human sense.
This guy is so anti Merriam-Webster dictionary. He's got his own dictionary, his own interpretation
as
of things.
As Rush Limbaugh has said many times.
His own interpretation of things.
The dictionary does not tell what conservatism is. I told you that Merriam-Webster does not understand liberal and conservative as character traits.
Right.
He does not.
Oh, by the
so
way.
How can you go and say.
By the way, the definition of populist was synonymous with liberalism and progressive. They were almost all three.
Don't say almost. You're qualifying. Well, almost does not mean the same.
All three, well, they were using synonymous words that were not put in the exact same
and
sentence.
And populist, which was a party. There is not a liberal party.
Okay.
There is not a conservative party.
Right, so the populists were made up of... progressives, liberals, what have you.
And whatever, yes.
So it was a party.
Yeah.
Okay.
Capital P.
Right.
Capital P.
Well, listen, regardless what the extreme vegans and animal rights activists say, there has been prey and predator for a hell of a long time on this planet Earth, and it still exists, and man will still kill for it will still eat meat and burgers and steaks and pork chops and what have you.
So they haven't changed many minds, have they?
Well, they want to change minds based on compassion for all animals.
But that wasn't my question. My question
but you
was...
you have to have evidence to back up your opinion!
And if they don't, they won't change other minds, will they?
It doesn't hold any water.
Well...
They don't have any evidence except for compassion for the cow.
I made that...
They don't have any other evidence.
They haven't changed many minds, have they?
Well, you kind of looking at it from a Machiavelli, you know, the ends justify the means. They haven't changed minds, but they don't have any besides compassion for the cow and the lamb and the pig. They don't have any other reason. We're talking about organic, healthy, non-toxic meat. We're not talking about the hormone-laden meats. There are people who just don't want to be vegans.
They have changed some minds, but they have not changed a lot of minds.
Right. Like, Gary knows is a vegan. Okay, I don't know. I can't speak for him that if he consumes dairy.
No.
Or eggs. Oh, I'm supposed to know what he fucking eats?
Yes, you're going, no.
What do you think I'm?
If you're going to make a criticism, you better know what.
Because he's a pacifist and he told me I can't call Oprah Winfrey a corporate whore. That's why I criticized him. A corporate whore is a corporate whore.
On his page. You can call him anything you want on your page. And my page. But not his page. That's all he told you.
Because he is not...
It has nothing to do with his not. He has a right to make that.
And I have a right to criticize it.
But you don't have a right to make that criticism on his page. I mean the criticism against Oprah.
Fuck your page and his page. How you like them apples? You like apples? Okay. How you like them apples? You like apples?
No.
You like apples?
You're not thinking fairly when you say that.
All right. It's his page. He can do what he wants. Just like the people. In fitness that want to steal other people's ideas, which is like a form of plagiarism, and call it their own and not give kudos to the person who originated, they can do anything they want in their business. That's what they do. People, they pick people's brains, they listen, they take ideas, they don't give kudos to the people that originated it, and they claim it's their own. Uh-huh. We're talking about blatant, selfish agendas.
What does that have to do?
It has to do with people. And I'm starting to read you like I read Ken.
What if?
It has to do with human nature. Sucks.
What if one came to your page and said something you did not
because
like?
Because my groups are uncensored.
I said, what?
My groups are not censored. I allow it.
Okay.
I allow it. Because they're uncensored. You know why they're uncensored? Because when I was members, before I had one group, when I was members of other groups, there were dictatorships, and they threatened to kick me out if I used such negative, toxic... pussies! Ultra-liberal pacifists!
You're not respecting their rights!
But I'm calling them what they are.
Fine, do it on your page.
But it's not... She's laughing because she don't believe in doing the show or having a newsletter or anything. Just want... Have dinner, have breakfast, go to the bathroom, take a shower, watch TV, and don't do anything else with your life. That's the reason.
What
I'm telling you,
all of that has to do with doing something on your page or not.
It has to do with people talking shit in the background. That's what has
to do. Who cares?
It's the same thing with people that have a group. You don't want it done on your page,
right?
They don't give me a reason.
I don't care. It's their page. They can do whatever the hell they want on their page.
Just like I can do what I want on
exactly. So what's the big deal?
The big deal is if somebody is not being 100% straight and honest, I have the right on my page to talk shit and tell the truth about them.
On your page, not Gary Null's page.
Right.
Thank you. Jeez.
It's not nice to call somebody a corporate whore. Well, she's a corporate whore. Because she was promoting non-GMO organic food, and then all of a sudden, she claimed to be in league with Monsanto.
Right.
That's called a hypocrite.
On your page.
So if Monsanto came to you and waved money in front of you, you might sell out too. Is that what you're trying to say? You're defending.
I would criticize Monsanto on my page.
I was trying. Because it's your
page. But it's my page.
But you're kissing up to people. You're kissing up to Gary. No, because he's rich and famous. That's why.
No, because he has a right to say what he wants on his page. Now, respect that, please. You want others to respect your page, or what you want to say,
no, but
you don't want to extend
it. No, but that's how he said it. He says, oh, James, you know, raise the bar in your vocabulary. Raise the bar. Oh, raise the bar is to sugarcoat everything when somebody is wrong and go easy on them. That's raising the bar.
He just understands that anger not directed properly and etc. kills people.
I directed it.
No, you didn't. You're angering at yourself. Here.
I called.
You're bitching at yourself.
I called the person. You're full of shit. You know I'm target. I was targeting Oprah for selling out. Or Hillary Clinton. Forget about Oprah.
Oprah has nothing to do with this conversation.
Or Hillary Clinton. No, it's called calling somebody out who's full of shit and exposing them.
On your page.
Yo, fuck.
On your page. Not on Gary Null's page.
Whoa. What kind of a progressive is William Eisenman? Tell me.
Doesn't matter. We're not talking about that.
We're not talking about that. Okay.
We're talking about your page, Gary Null's page, Gary's right to say what he wants on his page.
Okay.
And your right to say
on your page. I gotta do a show on more shows on not here, but on ultra liberals and how fucking phony they
Stop
are.
Stop the labeling. It has nothing to do with anything.
People are what they are, buddy.
Yeah, but not labels. People are people.
No, they're not.
Yes, they
are. People are not people.
What the hell are they?
People have ways of thinking, and they have tendencies.
But they're not labels. They're not generalizations.
Then what do you call somebody who fits into the category of being a pacifist Pollyanna? What do you call them?
Pacifist? Person who is a pacifist and a Pollyanna. What's wrong with that?
You don't say ultra liberal.
No. You don't label. They are not things on a shelf. They're people.
Ultra. Well, a liberal and a progressive. Well, okay. Libertarians. They come in two kinds. They come right-wing libertarians, and they come the left-wing, Jesse Ventura.
And then they come Rand Paul.
He's what, a moderate libertarian?
I don't know what he is. I'm not labeling him. I'm just.
Well, something.
He would call himself a libertarian, but he's not one of those two that you just said.
But there's difference between Jesse Ventura and a Lyndon LaRouche or Ron Paul libertarian. Is
Lyndon LaRouche runs as a Democrat.
He does.
Yes, he does. That's what I'm saying to you. Labels mean nothing. It's what people do.
Well,
period.
Well, if somebody is running as a libertarian,
doesn't matter, it's a party.
Usually the voters want to know where the person is coming from.
They may want to, but it ain't going to help.
Does it help now
when they say they're conservative? What the hell is a conservative today?
Well, I can tell you what they are today.
What?
They're usually pro-corporate, pro-selfishness, pro-rich.
But they don't think that. If you ask...
Again, with the perception of a person.
Exactly.
Who cares about perception if you can't back it up?
If you ask them to describe themselves today, they would not use those terms.
But they can have any fantasy they want about themselves.
But those are our terms for what they do.
So we have to respect their perception of what they do.
No, you don't have to respect anybody's perception. What does that have to do with
you
anything?
Don't want to label people because you don't want to offend anybody because you don't want to be labeled.
I offend a lot of people. That is not part of my problem. I'm telling you how to relate to people, not labels.
I don't give a shit because the proof is in the pudding. You ever hear that old saying?
Yeah. Now, if a conservative comes to you and is an ass kisser for a corporation,
right,
you have a right to say that.
Right.
But he won't say it. Yeah, you understand what I'm saying?
But it's what it is.
Exactly, but he won't call it like that.
I know people.
I know people who
actually think an American-made car is just the best car in the world, but they don't have any scientific proof or basis behind that. But they think it. Are they right? No. Do they think they're right? Yes.
How long did my Ford last me?
Well, if you want to keep it, you can keep on fixing it, and it'll last.
Well, any car needs fixing.
What about statistically? How does a car do statistically?
Have you ever seen those statistics? Because they don't exist.
You know what? Your American-made vehicles, electronics, and everything American-made is shit compared to foreign companies. Shit!
Where did these electronic things start out?
Here.
That's correct.
Who does it better? Them.
Why?
The attitude in business.
What happened with TIAC?
Huh?
TIAC, an American company. Tape recorders, etc. What happened?
I haven't seen them.
They gave Japan the rights to do that stuff, and they did it.
Well, Japan, South Korea, China, yeah, they...
The point is, America got rid of it. Why, of course the Japanese did it better. But it started here.
Well, they put more emphasis on quality and product R&D, research and development, and quality control, and less on greed.
That was only later. They didn't start out that way. They started out with the cheap shit from China.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And I think the president of Panasonic decided that made in Japan was not going to be a joke anymore. And then that's when everything changed.
That's correct. Yeah. But in America, you're not going to find it because they're not interested in giving you a quality product. They are interested in giving you a product every 3 years.
Yeah, built in obsolescence.
That's correct. Because the economy must always grow. It must grow.
What about growing with repeat loyal customers and good word of mouth?
Well, if you've already bought a car and the car's going to last you for 20 years, you're not going to buy another one.
Like a light bulb.
Like a light bulb.
Well, that's why people are buying foreign products.
That is why it is a flaw to believe that the economy must always grow.
True, I agree.
Okay. Now, as the population grows, maybe the economy will grow.
Well, a government, a capitalism, based on the corporation and all this economic growth, no matter where it comes from, it plain and simple, historically, statistically, capitalism has failed except for the rich. Point blank.
It hasn't failed because it never was supposed to.
Right. It was only supposed to
benefit those that have.
Yeah.
Pure and simple. It's right. The same argument I gave you about trickle down.
It can't trickle down.
Why would we be satisfied with trickle down when we have to siphon up first?
Trickle down, even if they allowed it to happen, would fail in the long run. It wouldn't work.
Why would we allow them to make that decision?
I agree.
Well,
I agree. But as far as the the labeling goes, that comes from the.
It comes from trying to compartmentalize.
Not wanting to offend people.
No. It comes from trying to make things that are hard much easier for the mind. I'm sorry, but human behavior is more complex than labels. Much more.
What about a person's track record? Let's say a senator's voting record throughout their career.
Well, that's a statistic. You can count that.
Like John McCain claiming he's
for veterans, but he votes against them every time.
There you go. Well, that sets up a pattern.
That's correct, and you can always use patterns as evidence.
Patterns,
but it's not a label.
And proof, like when Gary Nolan went to court with all that evidence with him. Proof.
As long as it's not a kangaroo court, it should win the day.
If you're willing to look at the proof and study it, and respect it and count it,
yeah. True. That requires that you're living in a fair world. We are not living in a fair world. We are living in the devil's world.
We're living in a world of dishonesty, deceit, lies, corruption, greed, all for me and the hell with everybody else. You know, I have mine, you don't have yours, I don't care. And that spells out the Republican Party and right-wing libertarians. That's them across the board. And some Democrats.
Thank you!
And some Democrats. Two-party system.
There are none that are good.
Corporate
system. None. None that are good.
Well, like the million-dollar man, DiBiase, they all have their price.
Everybody has a price.
And eventually, the million-dollar man will get you. Because everybody has their price. Oh, you don't want to sell your house? Oh, you have sentimental value, feelings for your home? How about this much? Oh, no.
Here's a sentimental $100 bill.
No, $100, not for a house.
Just to get started.
Thousands. Then next week, how about this amount we'll give you? Oh, I can't part with this home. I grew up in this home. All right, next week comes. How about this amount? Eventually, the person's going to say, you know what? The hell with my sentimental feelings. I'll take it.
There you go.
Because I'll be a fool not to take it.
That's correct.
So that's what probably happens.
I just bit my goddamn cheek.
That's what probably happens. That's what happens in this system of a two-party system, capitalism. So, what you got there, Chief? You got a humdinger?
No, it's
too late. Wrap it up?
Too late.
Why?
Too late? Stinking late.
It was too long. The reading is
too long. No, it wasn't too long. It's this jumbalone he keeps arguing here.
Because you keep on twisting what I'm saying. I'm saying if you have evidence.
No, you keep twisting what I'm saying.
You're putting value on perception. I'm putting value on proof to back up one's opinion. We were talking about animal rights.
Let's go back to the animal rights.
Veganism. Animal rights.
They didn't have any rights to try to to teach you what they wanted to teach you, correct?
I do have compassion.
No, just answer the
question. See what you're doing?
You're making it go wrong.
You see what he's doing? He wants to win. See, that's the thing. He wants to win.
An argument or teaching are not winnings and losings. Get that through your head. Education is not a winning and a losing game.
Yes, animals are killed.
No.
For
I ask you, did they have the proof to change your mind?
They had a little bit of proof.
Did it change your mind?
I mean, I've given them meat?
No, not
really.
All right. Did you offer them any proof?
Yeah, of course, about the
did it change their mind?
The virtues of eating meat? Yeah, I could come up with
something. Did it change their mind?
It most likely won't.
Thank you! That's the end of the argument.
So we shouldn't debate anybody is wrong. We shouldn't curse them out. We shouldn't expose them.
No, I just said that form of teaching does not work. You can debate, you can bitch, you can bop, anything you want. I just said that kind of teaching will not work and has not worked in the thousands of years that human beings have been on this planet.
So what you're saying is you'll get some here and there, you'll win some people over, but there are people that you just won't get to.
The only persons you will ever get to are the ones who do the homework on their own and come to your conclusion.
And then they get the light bulb over there. Bing!
Yeah.
I got it.
Thank you.
You know, okay. Like people that used to be Republican that are liberal now.
Like David Brock.
And one example.
David Brock wrote all the shit against Anita Hill with Clarence Thomas and all this shit, and then he found out later that he was all wrong. And he changed.
Unfortunately, in most cases, it's the progressive, liberal, bleeding heart person that gets swayed by the money and jumps ship and becomes corporatist and becomes, you know, the other way. You know what I mean? Unfortunately, that happens more than what you just said before about Brock. But anyway,
as long as you leave labels out of that, I'll agree with that. But not if you're going to label bleeding heart liberal.
Well, you know what?
What the hell? Who came up with
because
this bleeding heart?
Because a person's way of thinking and their patterns, their track record forms their mindset. Once you have a mindset formed before you, you have to call them something.
Not a label.
Why not? I'm not afraid of
offending. I'm a human being.
I'm not afraid of offending. Well, you know what? On my group, I'll hit hard and I'll tear people a new asshole on my group.
People.
I won't do it.
Not labels.
No. I'm going to label them.
Well, then it won't go anywhere. It's only good for bitching.
Well, bitching with evidence. I'll hit him with everything. The kitchen sink. You ever hear that? Throw it all in there.
You can have all the evidence you want.
And then call names.
And if you're only there for bitching, it ain't going to change nobody.
Listen, okay? Gary has a right for his
Oh, we're on Gary now.
To his approach. Well, you and Gary think alike.
No, we don't.
I know you're a meaty. You're a carnivore. He's a vegan. I know that.
Well, I don't know what that has
I'm
to do
talking
with
about sugarcoating the words you use for people, like Oprah and Hillary being corporate whores.
You're talking.
Some people don't want to use that term. I do.
You are talking about a way of trying to teach people by squeezing their heads. I'm saying that has never worked in all of the time human beings have been on this planet.
Well, by me talking about Oprah or Hillary or anybody else being that way, selling out, I'm not trying to teach people. I'm trying to expose and attack them like a piranha fish.
Thank you. Then that means that you don't care what they think. Because you're not trying to teach them.
No, just like Donald Trump doesn't care what
people
think.
You're just trying to yak.
No, it's not yakking. When you expose somebody for what they really are, it's not yakking.
What is it?
It's exposing them for what they are.
But you're not teaching. You just said. You're not teaching.
Well,
exposing should be a form of teaching.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So what do you want me to call people that sell? I can't say corporate whore. I have to say just sellouts. And not say whore.
I don't know. Did they sell out? Did they get money for their, you know?
Well, when a person first goes from pro non-GMO and pro organic,
they call it Gary Flip-Flopper.
And all of a sudden, They're cozying up to Monsanto.
Flip-flopper. Called Carrie Flip-flopper.
You know what? That what they do is too vile to just say flip-flop. What they're doing is too vile. It is too low. A hypocrite that does something like that is just too dirty, low down.
And expose the dirt that they do.
To
and
just
are
say
hurt.
Flip.
That they do.
You know what? I'll use the word corporate.
You know what I mean?
I use the word corporate.
Yeah,
I like the way it sounds.
Fine.
It's what they are, and it's also, it hits hard.
But what they do is the important thing. How they hurt people.
When you sell, if you sell out for money, and you sell out how you really feel because of monetary compensation. It's a form of prostitution. And therefore...
Yeah, but what does it do to our food? It allows poisoning of our food. I'm saying there is a bigger problem to just the selling out. It's the damage that they do.
No, see, this is why... Hey, you think I like... Elizabeth Warren and Bernie Sanders, the way they explain about Republicans, they're not my Republican colleagues. These are demons. These are corrupt, paid off, wicked demons. I don't like the liberal way of, I think it's not severe enough.
It may not be, but they are not under your knowledge of that part of it. They don't know they are demons.
How do you rile...
How do they know that they are demons?
How do you rile up the American population if you don't call it like it really is? When somebody allows poor people and children to go to bed hungry and turns your back on veterans that are homeless and people that need that are uninsured that don't have health care today, and you ignore that, you're evil. You're no good son of a bitch.
Thank you.
Yeah.
But explain the hurt.
Yeah.
Because that's the important part of the equation.
Yeah, of course.
It's the damage that they do.
Yeah, and I want to call them a corporate whore. Plus, on top of that.
Well, that's good, but they're worse than that.
Well, they're corporate. They're just plain old demons in the flesh.
They're demons, but, you know, like Bernie ain't going to understand demon.
No, well, colleague is like, it's like saying my co-workers, you know.
Well, they're in the Senate.
Why did they have to be colleagues? You know, you got to respect Donald for one thing. He tells it like it is,
yes.
And he don't care if people are offended. And I have to respect that.
But that can go too far.
Not if you're telling the truth.
Depends on the situation.
Let their feelings get hurt. It is. I only go by what is and what can be proven.
Well, what I'm saying is it can go too far. That's all I'm saying.
Oh, you're not going to say the word fuck on national TV.
Why not? Why can't we do that?
Because, you're right. Why can't we
do that? There are 7 words that we cannot say on TV and television, and radio, etc.
You don't want
George Carlin.
I'm not George Carlin. I'm not for frontal male nudity on TV and in movies at all, except for porn.
Why not? It's on HBO.
Not frontal.
But you have to pay for
not
it.
Not frontal male.
It's discrimination. We have to pay for it.
Yeah, but you don't want. Then there's nothing left to the imagination with sex.
Who cares? We're watching a movie. We want realism in the movie. Okay? And censorship only deprives us of realism.
Yeah. Well, kids that are curious probably just go on the internet and look it up anyway. So they know what it looks like, I guess. You know.
Why do they even know? Yeah. We got violence and brutality, and etc. all over the goddamn internet. And on television, all over the internet. God forbid we should have a dick get put into a vagina.
Yeah, but a dick and a pair of balls out in the open, isn't that a bit much? Dr. Bill?
No.
I mean, it's very...
Now you're talking about a person...
It's very graphic compared to a woman.
In a world where clothes...
A woman, everything is inside of her. But with a man, everything is just like...
But you're
wiggling and jiggling.
Of people who grow up with clothes.
Right.
If you didn't grow up with clothes, you wouldn't think like that.
Like nudist colony people.
Yeah. Okay. Why would you even think
these like people that? Are like naturalists. They're...
Whatever.
You're just another... one genitalia is just like another genitalia. You know, basically.
Every other animal, and even the ones with fur, they wear no clothes.
Their balls are swinging.
Their balls are swinging.
A dog, a male dog.
If you're a dachshund.
A male dog.
You know.
His balls are pendulum going back and forth as he's running.
Yeah.
So, alright, I agree. Yeah. What you got there, Chief? You got That's it?
Yeah.
Okay.
They're going to take a nap.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you gotta fight the enemy. You gotta fight the bully with force. You gotta out bully the bully.
Christie tried that with Rand Paul on the debate.
Christie tried to bully Rand Paul.
It didn't work.
Christie tried to bully, yes, Christie tried to overshadow and interrupt and drown out Rand Paul. You know, he's you know, going at it.
And Rand Paul took the Snowden point of view, and Christie said that he liked spying on us, innocent Americans.
Oh, Christie agrees with
this? Yeah.
Then Christie likes fascism, I guess.
Bingo! Wowee! A Republican likes fascism.
So
wowee!
Well, Christie I think Christy would love to be an emperor, you know, with clothes. An emperor.
I wouldn't want to see him without fucking clothes.
No, we don't want
okay?
that.
Okay, jeez.
I think he really, based on his personality, that he would love to be part of a totalitarian system with him in charge. I just get that impression.
George Bush said it.
Yeah. You know, plus...
He didn't mind a dictator as long as he was a dictator.
I mean, he was acting like he was compassionate, hugging people during times of disaster, you know, with the storm and the sand.
G.W. Bush was supposed to be the compassionate conservative.
You know, he was telling Rand Paul, you weren't there in people's lives. I was hugging yeah. people. You were hugging people. The people that lost their homes, I think they're still waiting for their money.
They are 3 years later.
But they got hugs from Chris Christie.
Hey, whoop-de-doo.
That's why the whole Republican debate was such an insane asylum of lies. You know, but I do have to salute. I'm not a Republican by any stretch of the imagination. I will never vote for a conservative. But Donald Trump, man, I have to respect his outspokenness, his candor, and not caring about what other people think. And I know the guy was under attack because he's not a career politician. He's a businessman. They introduced him as the businessman. Donald Trump.
You see how he arrived on his own plane.
Making deals. I like when Trump was talking with his hands up. I mean, making deals. I'm making deals.
Black, red, and white plane with the word Trump painted on it.
A little egomaniacal, do you think?
I would say. He had Trump on his buildings in Atlantic City, didn't he? Trump Plaza?
Everywhere. Yeah, well, he's full of himself, you know.
Yes.
I like when you have my big deals. I make the deal. I'm the expert at the deals. I just thought that was...
Yeah, he made a deal with Mark Griffin for Paradise Island.
Bahamas. Well, who...
Sold it to him when it was a piece of shit.
He sold Merv.
Fortunately, Merv, you know, brought it back to making a profit, but...
Yeah, how's it doing
now? It was
a piece
of shit when he dealt it to him.
But that's what Donald does. He buys low and sells high, right?
That's why he said to Chris Wallace, when Chris Wallace was...
You went bankrupt 4 times.
No. My businesses went bankrupt. I didn't ever go bankrupt.
Then
he told Chris, he said, Chris,
yeah, but your investors, you know.
Hey, Chris, my investors were killers. They're not the little babies that you think they are. They hell are, because those people who invest in stuff like that, they got the moolah.
Yeah,
throw around.
He was honest. He says, I got out of Atlantic City
before it going down.
Down. He knew what was going to happen, and he got out. He made a smart business decision. You know, I mean, they were nitpicking and throwing questions at him that were not questions that a presidential candidate should really have to answer. You know, talk about the real issues here. Fat chance getting the Mexican government to pay for a wall. Don't hold your breath on that. That's not going to happen. And they can always tunnel under the wall.
Well, that's what he said.
They tunnel, so
we'll
go to
the wall.
We'll put
up the wall until El Chapo tunnels under it.
But they tunnel now. So what good is a wall going to do if they tunnel?
What about crossing the Rio Grande?
It's all dry. It's the Skeleton River, right?
Jeez.
I think by El Paso and Juarez, I don't think there's any water in it.
Now, what about... They come across the border and everything. What about this marine or whatever the hell he was who made the wrong turn and went into Mexico? He's still in jail as far as I know.
They threw away the key, huh?
Yeah.
Yes, the United States is SEAL Team 6 saving him?
Yeah.
No, but the whole thing about the wall, I was very shocked that such an intelligent man like Donald Trump would mention building a wall. If the drug cartel, drug trafficking people tunnel, they tunnel.
Or if you get an 8-foot wall, they'll get a 10-foot ladder.
And if you get an 8-foot, if you get a 20-foot wall that also goes 10 feet into the ground, well, they'll tunnel under that. No matter what you throw at them in the form of a wall.
They're going to come here. They're going to come here.
They're going to find a way.
And in fact, I heard the evidence the other day that most of the people that are coming in now are not from Mexico. They're from Honduras, El Salvador, Nicaragua, etc.
Because they're working... Look, anywhere...
There are no jobs.
All these third world countries south of the border where there's lots of very poor people... will do what they have to do to survive.
Yes.
And the cops, I hear the cops in Latin America are not paid like the cops in the United States. They're paid shit.
That's why there's so much corruption.
And that's why, you know, if you want anything illegal, the best thing is to walk up to a Latin American cop and he'll tell you where to go, where to find him.
Oh, he'll tell you where to go, all right.
No, but
I know.
If you give them a little gift, they'll hook you up because they don't make that much money. Mm-hmm. Anyway, we'll see you next week. Thank you for joining us for Uncensored Hard-Hitting Truth. Bye-bye.
This has been a Megalife 21 production.